சாப்பிடலாமா?
குட் ஈவினிங்.
குட் ஈவினிங்.
குட் ஈவினிங்.
குட் ஈவினிங்.
வணக்கம்.
வணக்கம்.
மாமழை போற்றுதும் மாமழை போற்றுதும் வெல்கம் டு தி 10th லெக்சர் ஆஃப் தி வராஹ மிஹிரா சயின்ஸ் ஃபோரம் அண்ட் கோஹோஸ்டட் பை தமிழ் ஹெரிடேஜ் ட்ரஸ்ட் அண்ட் தமிழ் வர்ச்சுவல் அகாடமி. மை நேம் இஸ் கோபு. ஐ வில் கிவ் அ ப்ரீஃப் இன்ட்ரடக்ஷன் டு ஆல் த்ரீ இன்ஸ்டிடியூஷன்ஸ். I'd first like to thank Tamil Virtual Academy for this provision of this hall. Like, they've been doing it for a couple of our lectures. It's part of the government of Tamil Nadu. They have started as a internet venture to educate the Tamil public about a lot of Tamil heritage, history, culture, and several aspects of literature and so on. They have a lot of online classes. They have a lot of literature and heritage monuments, information about all that on their website, tamilvu.org, which is from the days when it was called Tamil Virtual University. They have a monthly lecture series besides this one. This is kind of a temporary arrangement. They have one called under the Thakavalaatru Padai scheme. So that's about Tamil Virtual Academy. Tamil Heritage Trust was started a few years back by several people. Its purpose also is to to inform the public with monthly lectures, annual site seminars, and annual pechu kacheris about Tamil heritage and related things, including Indian heritage, to the larger general public. Couple of the December pechu kacheris last year on Kanchipuram and the previous year on Mamallapuram were hosted here by Tamil Virtual Academy. These are conducted by Tamil Heritage Trust. Varaha Mihira Science Forum is a slightly more specialized kind of forum. We started about a year back because there is a shortage of public fora or lectures about science in general that was not targeted at professional scientists and professional engineers, professional doctors and so on, or outside of the professional institutions like the IITs and the medical colleges and other technological research institutes. So இது வந்து தமிழ்நாட்டுக்கு மக்கள் பார்க்குறதுக்கும் தமிழில் இப்போ சில சமயத்தில் பேசுகிறதுக்கும் இந்தியாவில் நடக்கக்கூடிய இல்லை உலகத்தில் நடக்கக்கூடிய விஞ்ஞான விஷயங்கள் பல விதத்தையும் பொதுமக்களுக்கு எடுத்துக்கொண்டு போகிறதுக்காக ஆரம்பிக்கப்பட்ட ஒரு ஃபாரம். அன்ஃபார்ச்சுனேட்லி வி ஹவ் மோஸ்ட்லி ஹேட் லெக்சர்ஸ் இன் இங்கிலீஷ் ஒன்லி. ஐ திங்க் ப்ராபப்ளி பிகாஸ் தி வொகேபுலரி ஆஃப் மோஸ்ட் ஆஃப் தி modern science that you're dealing with is substantially in English. So we occasionally had references to quotations from, you know, Tamil literature. For example, Dr. Singhananjan here, who gave a lecture on the geology and several aspects and about the movement of rivers, referred to bhakti poetry and Salapadikaram and so on. And I think Shashwath also, with reference to the monsoon, will make references to classical Tamil literature and perhaps, you know, some of references from Kalidasa's Meghadutha, for example. So that also comes. But adha Tamil la pesuradhu adutha maasa lecture indha maasa actually pesa vendi ivanga last minute la withdraw pannitaanga. Avanga vandu aasthana kolahalam abdingra oru Tamil nool, kanithatha patti rendu Tamil noolgal irukkara, kanakadhigaram nu ondru, aasthana kolahalam nu innonu. Andha aasthana kolahalatha patti adutha maasam Dr. Sita Sundararaman nu pesirukanga. So this forum has started because Madras has the reputation as the cultural capital of India. But culture na invariably art, literature, painting, music mattum pesrom. Science, commerce usually gets neglected even though they are culture. So yana because they are thought of as a separate field, I suppose. So adha pathi pesanongradhukosram we wanted to integrate, we started this forum. Lectures are popular lectures are few and far between or something. Of a matter of concern. We wanted to build a community based on the people who attend these lectures and other activities and so on. We have a WhatsApp group running. So at the end of the program, you can give me or a couple of our friends your phone number if you have a WhatsApp, and then we'll notify you of all these programs. We also have a Facebook page. You can just follow it. It's Varahamira Science Forum. Tamil Heritage has a separate page, and of course Tamil Virtual Academy has a very broad website itself, tamilvu.org. And we are interested not just in telling the, you know, most complicated science and the latest things, but even things that should be well known in a in a encouraging, perhaps enthusiastic manner. நிறைய பேர் வந்து இது மாதிரி பேசும்போது சயின்ஸில் வந்து இன்ட்ரெஸ்டே கெடுக்கிற மாதிரி சொல்லித்தராங்க கிளாஸ் ரூமில் அப்படிங்கிற ஒரு ஃபீலிங் வருது. சயின்டிஃபிக் ப்ரோக்ராம்ஸ்க்கும் வந்து இந்த லெவல் ஆஃப் நாலேஜ் இருந்தால் தான் இதை ஃபாலோ பண்ண முடியும் அப்படிங்கிற மாதிரி தான் பேசுகிறாங்க. ஒரு பொதுமக்களுக்காக, அது வந்து பொதுமக்கள்னால் வந்து சயின்ஸில் ஈடுபாடு உண்றவங்கன்னு இல்லை, ஒரு இன்ஜினியராக இருந்தாருன்னா மெடிக்கல் விஷயத்தை வந்து அவருக்கு புரிகிற மாதிரி சொல்கிறதுக்கு முயற்சியோ இல்லை, அந்த மாதிரி ஒரு மெடிக்கல் ஃபீல்டில் இருந்தாருன்னா மற்ற சயின்ஸ் ஃபீல்ட்ஸில் ஃபிசிக்ஸை பற்றி பேசுகிறதோ வந்து நல்லா செய்யலை, அது போதுமான அளவு செய்யலை அப்படிங்கிற ஒரு வருத்தம் நிறைய பேருக்கு இருக்குது. ஸோ வி வாண்டட் டு கெட் போத் அமெச்சர் அண்ட் ப்ரொஃபஷனல் ஸ்பீக்கர்ஸ் அண்ட் நாட் ஜஸ்ட் சப்ஸ்டன்ஸ் பட் ஆல்சோ வித் ஸ்டைல் அண்ட் யூனோ கேட்சி ப்ரெசன்டேஷன். ஸோ வி ஆர் ஸோ if you are interested in doing is contributing is providing us ideas, we welcome you. We've had people come and volunteer and contribute to us. We'd like to have lectures in Tamil. Probably we'll start we'll continue that theme next month, though there are references now. We also would like to expand this. If we do is continue this forum here, then it will be a bit of a disappointment. We wanted to expand, we wanted to inspire, we wanted to move to other cities and so on, and to move to colleges, schools, campuses and all that. We kind of do it on an individual basis now. சில பேர்லாம் ஸ்கூலில் எங்களுக்கு வந்து கூப்பிட்டு ஏதாவது அந்த மாதிரி ஏதாவது சொல்லுன்னு கேட்குறாங்க. ஸோ அந்த மாதிரி சில இடத்துல பண்ணுறோம். கார்பரேஷன் ஸ்கூல் மாதிரி சில ஸ்கூலுக்கும் பேசுகிறோம், அதுவும் நடக்குது. ஆக்டிவிட்டீஸ் அண்ட் ஹெரிட்டேஜ் வாக்ஸும் பண்ணணும்னு ஆர்வப்படுறோம். வில் ப்ராப்ளி ஸ்டார்ட் இட் ஆஃப்டர் அவர் ஃபஸ்ட் இயர். ஸோ இஸ் ஒன்லி த 10th மந்த் ஆஃப் அவர் ஆக்டிவிட்டீஸ். And it's not new. We had a Bertrand Russell Society about 40-50 years back. அது என்ன ஆச்சுன்னு தெரியல, எப்படி ஆரம்பிச்சதுன்னு தெரியல. We had Arvind Gupta, was probably very famous. Most of you have heard of him. அவர் வந்து ஐஐடியில் ஒரு ப்ரோக்ராம் பண்ணார். த காஸ்மோனாட் ஆஸ்ட்ரோநாட் ராகேஷ் சர்மா, அவர் ஃபஸ்ட் ஆஸ்ட்ரோநாட், ஐஐடியில் ஒரு வாட்டி பேசினார். ஃபீல்ட்ஸ் மெடலிஸ்ட் மஞ்சுள் பார்கவா சான்ஸ்கிரிட் காலேஜில் கேஎஸ்ஆர்ஐயில் வந்து பேசினார். தெர் வாஸ் அ பாஸ்கராச்சாரியா ஒர்க் ஷாப். பாரத் ரத்னா சிஎன்ஆர் ராவ், அவரை பற்றி நிறைய பேர் கேள்விப்பட்டதில்லை. தெந்துல்கரும் அவருக்கும் ஒரே நாளில் பாரத் ரத்னா கொடுத்தாங்க. தெந்துல்கர் எல்லாருக்கும் தெரியுது, சிஎன்ஆர் ராவ் தெரியல. அவரும் ஐஐடியில் லெக்சர் பண்ணார். எல்லாம் ஐஐடியிலேயே லெக்சர் பண்ணுறதுனால பொதுமக்கள் போகிறதுக்கு தயங்குறாங்க. ஏகாம்ரேணி வாசு, நீங்கள் அல்லாடி ஃபேமிலியோடைய வீட்டில் வந்து ராமானுஜம் படி லெக்சர் நடந்திருக்கு. மேத் சயின்ஸ் இதில் ஒரு முக்கியமான இடம் எடுத்திருக்காங்க. தே ஹவ் டன் சம் 2 இயர்ஸ் தே ஹவ் டன் டேக்கன் சயின்ஸ் டு த பப்ளிக் வித் ஃபோரம் வித் அ ப்ரோக்ராம் கால் சயின்ஸ் அட் தி சபா. There are other institutions that do it. Venus Transit and Mercury Transit, twice Venus Transit in fact, in 2008 and 2012. The Birla Planetarium right down this road conducted that. A bunch of people, enthusiastic people attended that. I was one of them. These are photos from that I took at that point. Tamil Nadu is one of the, Madras is one of the few metropolitan cities from where you can actually see ISRO's rocket launches. இங்கே மொட்டை மாடியில் போய் நீங்கள் யூ கேன் சி நாட் மெனி பிளேசஸ் கேன் போஸ்ட் ஆஃப் தட் கைண்ட் ஆஃப் this thing. Sorry, the font has gone a little awry here. Fortunately, the launches are going very well. Left la irukkaradhu yen veettu maadiyil irundhu eduthathu, right la irukkaradhu inga pakkathula irukka Anna library maadiyil irundhu oru 6th maadi 7th maadiyil irundhu eduthathu. You can see these from there also. So good interest. We started off the series with a lecture on Antoine Lavoisier. I did that. We had a few lectures where we charged entry fee for about 100 rupees for the people, mainly for the collection towards the hall rent. Fortunately, Tamil Virtual Academy has given us this hall for free, so we are not charging. But if you want to contribute anything to us, we are more than happy to do that. Your presence is the most fundamental contribution. I hope you encourage other people to come to our programs. Then we had a lecture by Badri on single helix, double helix and triple helix about the discovery of the structure of proteins, then DNA and collagen. The first two are famous. The third was actually done here by an Indian scientist called G.N. Ramachandran, whose photo you see there. There was a lecture substantially in Tamil by a friend called Sivaraman, who writes regularly in Tamil magazines like Dinamalar and Dinamani. Hidden phages, the bacteriophage is a bit of a pun on the word. Bacteriophage is a type of creature. That bacteriophage is more numerous than all other life forms put together. Bacteria, plants, animals, ellathoda ennike eduthinga, bacteriophage is more numerous. Adhu konja ana nariya perukku theriyala adha patti. ஐசக் நியூட்டனை பற்றி சித்தார்த்தன் ஒருத்தர் பேசினார். அல்லாடி ராமகிருஷ்ணனுடைய இந்த ஒரு சயின்ஸ் செமினார் சீரீஸ் வந்து இன்ஃபேக்ட் தட் இஸ் ஒன் ஆஃப் த ஃபேமஸ் அண்ட் இன்ஃப்ளூயன்ஷியல் சயின்ஸ் செமினார் சீரீஸ். அது வந்து அவருடைய வீட்டில் நடந்தது, அல்லாடி ராமகிருஷ்ணன் அல்லாடி கிருஷ்ணசாமி ஐயர் வீட்டில் நடந்தது. தட் லெட் டு தி ஃபார்மேஷன் ஆஃப் த மேட் சயின்ஸ். அதை பற்றி கிருஷ்ணசாமி அல்லாடிங்கிறது அவர் ஃபவுண்டருடைய பையனே இங்கே வந்து பேசினார், டிசம்பரில் பேசினார். ஓ ஐம் சாரி, தெர் இஸ் மோர், தெர் ஆர் ஓகே, அதை தாண்டி தெர் ஆர் கப்புள் அதர்ஸ் டாக்டர். ஸோ அட்டாமிக் தியரி அண்ட் அலமேலு பாட்டின்னு ஒரு ஃபர்மி லேபில் ஒர்க் பண்ணுறவர் வந்து ஒரு லெக்சரன் கொடுத்தாரு. அது ஒரு பொதுமக்களுக்கு ரீச் பண்ணுறதுக்கோசரம் ஒரு கேட்சி டைட்டில் அது. டாக்டர் சிங்கானஞ்சன் அஃப்கோர்ஸ் ஜியலாஜிக்கல் சர்வே ஆஃப் இந்தியாவில் இப்போ தான் ரிட்டையர் ஆனார், சீஃபாக ரிட்டையர் ஆனார். அவர் ஐஸ் ஐ டோல் யூ எர்லியர் ஹி கேவ் அஸ் அ லெக்சர் ஆன் த ஜியாலஜி ஆஃப் த பாலார் ரிவர் அண்ட் லிட்டரரி கனெக்ஷன்ஸ் அண்ட் ஆல் தட். தென் வி ஹேட் அ கப்புள் மோர் லெக்சர்ஸ் இன் தி ஹிஸ்டாரிக்கல் ஆஸ்பெக்ட்ஸ் ஆஃப் ஹவு டெக்னாலஜி கேம் டு மெட்ராஸ். வெங்கடேஷ் ராமகிருஷ்ணன் ஒரு நாவலிஸ்ட் வந்து பேசினார். அப்புறம் லாஸ்ட் மந்த் வி ஹேட் நரசையா, பாப்புலர் ரைட்டர், ஃபார்மர் ஏன்னோ நேவியில் ஒர்க் பண்ணவர், ஐஎன்எஸ் விக்ரந்த் ஏர்க்ராஃப்ட் கேரியரில் சீஃப் டெக்ஸ் ஆஃபீஸராக இருந்தார். அவர் வந்து ஏர்க்ராஃப்ட் கேரியர் பற்றியும் ஹவு தி சி கேரியர் இன் த சி ஷேப்ட் இஸ் லைஃப் அப்படிங்கிறத பற்றி ஆட்டோபயோகிராஃபிக்கலாக பல இது சொன்னார். அதில் இன்ஜினியரிங் ஆஸ்பெக்ட்ஸ் பலதையும் சொன்னார். ஜஸ்ட் ரீசன்ட்லி வி கன்க்ளூடட் அவர் ஃபர்ஸ்ட் சம்மர் கேம்ப். ஐ கண்டக்டட் ஒன் ஆஃப் த டூ செஷன்ஸ் ஆன் இண்டியன் மேத்தமேட்டிக்ஸ் அண்ட் அஸ்ட்ரானமி அப்படின்னு ஒரு ஃபைவ் டே செஷன் நடத்தினேன். சித்தார்த்தன் அந்த நியூட்டன் பற்றி பேசினார் இல்லையா, அவர் வந்து ஒரு டூ டே கேம்ப் ஆன் வேரியஸ் சயின்ஸ் எக்ஸ்பெரிமெண்ட்ஸ் ஃபார் த சில்ட்ரன் அப்படின்னு பண்ணார். இது சிக்ஸ் ஸ்டாண்டர்ட்லேருந்து டென்த் ஸ்டாண்டர்ட் வரைக்கும் பசங்களுக்கோசரம் நாங்கள் பண்ணோம். தெர் இஸ் அ டிமாண்ட் ஃபார் திஸ், ஸோ வி மே டூ இட் ஃபார் அடல்ட்ஸ் லேட்டர் ஆன். வித்தவுட் மோர் அடு ஐ வுட் இன்ட்ரடியூஸ் ஷாஷ்வத் நெக்ஸ்ட். ஷாஷ்வத் இஸ் த ஸ்பீக்கர் ஆஃப் த டே. He is not really a meteorologist. In fact, most of the people are not experts in their field. Dr. Singhananjan and Alladi and Akash being exceptions. Most of the people are speaking fields outside their area of expertise. அதில் ஒரு என்ன அட்வான்டேஜ்னா, பொதுமக்களுக்கு கொஞ்சம் ரொம்ப எக்ஸ்பர்ட் லெவலில் போகாமல் கொஞ்சம் நல்லாவே புரிகிற மாதிரி சொல்லுவாங்கன்றது எங்களுடைய ஒரு நம்பிக்கை. இது வந்து சுவாமிநாதன் சார் பாயிண்ட் அவுட் பண்ணி அவரை அந்த தமிழர் ட்ரேட் டெஸ்ட்ல பல வருஷம் பண்ணதுனால அதை நாங்கள் செஞ்சிட்ருக்கோம். ஷாஷ்வத் இஸ் அன் இன்ஜினியர், இஸ் அவர் நடுநடுவில் இன்ஜினியரிங்கும் பண்ணுறாரு. ஆனால் அவர் மற்ற ஆர்வங்கள்லாம் ரொம்ப பலமாகவே இருக்கும். கோயில்கள்லாம் வந்து ரொம்ப கலைக்காக ரொம்ப ஆர்வப்பட்டு பல இடத்துக்கு போவார். அந்த மாதிரி சில நண்பர்கள் இங்கெல்லாம் இருக்கும். பொன்னியின் செல்வன் ஆஃப் கல்கி இஸ் ஒன் ஆஃப் ஹிஸ் இன்ஸ்பிரேஷன்ஸ். ஹி யூனோ கோஸ் அரவுண்ட் ஆன் செவரல் யூனோ வாட்டர் சம்திங் இஸ் ஆஃப் பிட் ஆஃப் அன் அப்சஷன் வித்தும். அந்த 2015 அந்த வெள்ளம் வரும்பொழுது அவர் தனியாக கார்ட்டோகிராஃபிக் சாஃப்ட்வேர்லாம் எடுத்து அடையாருடைய வாட்டர் சோர்ஸஸ்லாம் எப்படி வருதுன்னு ஒரு பெருசாக ஃபேஸ்புக்கில் அதெல்லாம் தொடர்ந்தார். கூவம் கல்ச்சரல் மேப்பிங், அடையார் கல்ச்சரல் மேப்பிங்னு வெங்கடேஷ் ரெண்டு ஒரு கைண்ட் ஆஃப் கல்ச்சரல் என்டர்பிரைஸ் ரெண்டு எடுத்துட்டாரு. அதில் ஷாஷ்வத் ஒன் ஆஃப் த கீ கான்ட்ரிபியூட்டர்ஸ். ஹி கேவ் அஸ் அ ஒண்டர்ஃபுல் லெக்சர் ஃபார் தமிழ் ஹெரிட்டேஜ் டிரஸ்ட் லாஸ்ட் இயர் ஆன் த ஹைட்ராலிக் ஹெரிட்டேஜ் ஆஃப் தமிழ்நாடு. தமிழ்நாட்டில் வந்து எப்படி வாட்டர் நதிகளை எப்படி வந்து கண்ட்ரோல் பண்ணியிருக்காங்க, அதனுடைய தண்ணி எப்படி ஹார்வெஸ்ட் பண்ணியிருக்கோம், ஏரி குளங்கள்லாம் எப்படி பராமரிப்பு நடந்திருக்கு, அதை அந்த டேம் கட்டினாங்களா கட்டலையா, அது சேனலா ரெகுலேட்டரா, கரை கரிகாலன் கரை எடுத்தான்னா என்ன கரை எடுத்தான், அதனுடைய பயன் என்ன, எப்படி இந்த ஏரி குளங்கள்லாம், இது 2 மாதம் மழை பெய்கிற ஒரு நாட்டில் எப்படி 12 மாதம் விவசாயம் நடந்தது, இதை பற்றிலாம் வந்து ஒரு ஒண்டர்ஃபுல் லெக்சர் கொடுத்துருக்கேன், அது யூடியூப்பில் இருக்குது. ஸோ வென் யூ ஜம்ப் வென் யூ இது ஆக்சுவலி திஸ் வாஸ் சப்போஸ் டு ஹேப்பன் 4-5 மந்த்ஸ் பேக் இந்த மிடில் ஆஃப் த லாஸ்ட் மான்சூன். பட் அன்ஃபார்ச்சுனேட்லி அட் தட் டைம் ஆக்சுவலி ஹேட் டு டூ இஸ் ப்ரொஃபஷனல் ஒர்க் அஸ் அன் இன்ஜினியர். ஸோ அது போஸ்ட்போன் ஆயிடுச்சு. பட் ஃபைனலி அட்லீஸ்ட் ஆன் அ வெரி இன்ட்ரெஸ்டிங் டேட் ஹீ இஸ் மேனேஜ் டு யூனோ அக்செப்டட் டு கிவ் அஸ் திஸ் லெக்சர் ஆன் த மான்சூன்ஸ். ஸோ வித்தவுட் ஃபர்தர் அடு ஐ இன்வைட் ஷாஷ்வத் டு கிவ் இஸ் லெக்சர். தேங்க்யூ.
தேங்க்யூ கோபு. இது ஜஸ்ட் 2 நோட்ஸ் பிஃபோர் ஐ பிகின். கோபு மென்ஷன் லாட் ஆஃப் இன்ஸ்டிடியூஷன்ஸ் விச் ஹவ் பீன் டூயிங் பப்ளிக் லெக்சர்ஸ். இதில் ஒன்று ஆட் பண்ணிக்கணும், விச் இஸ் வேர் ஐ காட் மை இனிஷியல் கிரவுண்டிங் இன் சயின்ஸ். சில்ட்ரன்ஸ் கிளப் எட் ஆன் விஎம் ஸ்ட்ரீட் கண்டக்ட்ஸ் சயின்ஸ் லெக்சர்ஸ் ஃபார் ஸ்டூடெண்ட்ஸ், ஸ்கூல் அண்ட் காலேஜ் ஸ்டூடெண்ட்ஸ். அண்ட் இந்த 9th and 10th கிளாஸ் I was a regular at those lectures, and that's where I actually got my, I improved my more systematic understanding and love for science, if I can say that. The second note is that I have also been very lucky this time. Last year when we talked about doing the monsoons, appo vandu correct ah mid monsoon la irundhathu. So we thought that would be a good time to do it. Unfortunately, it got delayed. Fortunately or unfortunately, it got delayed to this day. And as we are talking, the monsoon is just off the coast of Kerala. IMD says that it is a few days early. Exactly, ennike cross ahun theriyadu. Maybe it's already crossing, because this is the satellite image from this morning. And probably the initial showers are already on the coast of Kerala. Na yen the monsoon ngra topic eduthinenaka, I have been last year I did a talk on Aries. I've been very interested in water. But while I was talking about water as something that comes, அது எங்கேருந்து அந்த மழை வருது எப்படி வருது வை இஸ் இட் தட் ஒரு வருஷம் வி ஹாவ் ஃப்ளட் த நெக்ஸ்ட் இயர் வி ஹாவ் அ சைக்ளோன் த நெக்ஸ்ட் இயர் வி ஹாவ் அ ட்ரவுட் அண்ட் தென் அகெயின் ஹூ நோஸ் வாட் வி ஆர் கோயிங் டு ஹாவ் திஸ் இயர் அந்த ப்ராசஸ்ஸை கொஞ்சம் அண்டர்ஸ்டாண்ட் பண்ணாக்க தான் வி கேன் மூவ் ஆன் டு நெக்ஸ்ட் ஸ்டேஜ் ஆஃப் அண்டர்ஸ்டாண்டிங் ஆஃப் ஹவு டு யூஸ் த வாட்டர் ஆர் ஹவு டு டீல் வித் த வாட்டர் ஆஸ் இட் கம்ஸ் இன் டு அவர் லைவ்ஸ் Monsoon is a very majestic, very overpowering sensation. You must understand it's a single physical process with hundreds and hundreds of variables. I believe the IMD tracks some 30 to 40 variables at each point on the Earth's surface just to be able to predict the monsoon with the inaccuracy that we all know that is there. When we joke about meteorologists making predictions that don't come true, adu evlo kashtamana oru subject nu nammalku theriyanum. And if we understand my belief is that if we understand the process of the monsoon much better, then we will understand what the differences in the prediction and the what actually happens are, and we will be able to make much better decisions in that way. Gopu correct a oru the silapadiharathil endu aarambichar malai potrudum appadina. Unfortunately, this is practically one of the very few classical quotes that I have. இது ஒரு வார்த்தை வச்சுண்டு லெட் அஸ் மூவ் ஆன். ஐ கெனாட் யூஸ் டூ மெனி ஃபார் த சேம் ரீசன் தட் கோபு அலூடட் டு. ஐ கெனாட் யூஸ் டூ மெனி டூ மச் தமிழ் இன் திஸ் பர்டிகுலர் லெக்சர் பிகாஸ் த அமௌண்ட் ஆஃப் இன்ஃபர்மேஷன் தட் இஸ் தேர் டுடே அபவுட் த மான்சூன்ஸ் ப்ரிடாமினன்ட்லி கம்ஸ் ஃப்ரம் த லாஸ்ட் 100 இயர்ஸ் அண்ட் ஆல் ஆஃப் தட் ரிசர்ச் சொல்லவே வேண்டாம் இங்கிலீஷில் தான் இருக்குது. So for anybody who doesn't know Tamil who is listening, I will translate also. Praise be the mighty cloud. Praise be the mighty cloud. இங்கே வந்து மழை அப்படின்னாக்க க்ளவுடை இந்த மேகத்தை தான் சிக்னிஃபை பண்ணுறாங்க. For like him whose land the frightful sea surrounds, they stand on high and pour their gifts on men below. அதே sentiment நம்ம வந்து சிலப்பதிகாரத்துலேருந்து we go back 1000 years and 1500 years, 2000 years, எவ்வளோ வேணாலும் சொல்லிக்கலாம் நம்ம. அண்ட் வி கோட் நார்த் ரிக்வேதத்தில் அதே இருக்குது. எதுக்கு நான் ஒரு ஃப்ராகை போட்டிருக்கேன், டூ ஃப்ராக்ஸ். தே ஹூ லே குவயட் ஃபார் எ இயர் ஹூ ஃபுல்ஃபில் தேர் வாவ்ஸ் த ஃப்ராக்ஸ் ஹவ் அப்லிஃப்டட் தேர் வாய்ஸ் த வாய்ஸ் பர்ஜன்யா ஹஸ் இன்ஸ்பயர்டு. இது வந்து ரால்ஃப் கிரிஃபித்தோட டிரான்ஸ்லேஷன் ஆஃப் ரிக்வேதா. This comes in Mandala 7 and the verse is 103. This is a much longer one. Now, there are 4 passages. The important thing here is the last passage where they keep 12 months God's appointed order and never do men neglect the season. Soon as the rain time in the year returns, these who were heated kettles gain their freedom. ஸோ இதில் என்ன பார்க்க வேண்டியதுனாக்க, த மான்சூன் இஸ் அ சைக்கிள். the fact that the rain returns every year without fail has been noted by every culture in India. This shapes our culture in such unimaginable ways. So, in the passage, there is one word, parjanya. That word parjanya is the word for cloud in Sanskrit. Anna Sanskrit lo oru word illa cloud ku. Mega varida vani jalada dharada. The Amarakosha lists 15 different words for clouds. 3 words for thunder, 10 words for lightning, 2 words for the thunder clap, 2 words for the lightning flash, 3 different words for rainbows, 2 different words for rains, 2 different words for rout, 2 words for continuous rains, words for droplets, hail, cloudy days. அது வந்து ரெயின், கண்டினியூஸ் ரெயின், கொஞ்சம் தூர்ற மழை, எவ்ரி திங் இஸ் டிஸ்டிங்விஷ்ட். அவ்வளவுக்கு அவ்வளவு இது ஆராய்ச்சி பண்ணி யூனிஃபார் ஆன்சிஸ்டர்ஸ் ஹேட் நோன் திஸ் மச். அன்ஃபார்ச்சுனேட்லி தே டிட் நாட் நோ வை. தே ஓன்லி நியூ தட் திஸ் வாஸ் அ வெரி ஸ்ட்ரேஞ்ச் ஃபினாமினன் தட் ஹேப்பன்ட். த விண்ட் ப்ளோஸ் ஹாஃப் வே ஃபார் ஒன் இயர், ஃபார் ஹாஃப் தி இயர் இட் ப்ளோஸ் ஒன் வே, and then for the other half of the year it blows another way. The monsoon invades, you can see what is happening here. The monsoon invades the subcontinent, starts in Kerala, moves in, covers the entire subcontinent and then retreats. It happens almost on an appointed day. It starts and on an appointed day you can practically say within 3 or 4 days that it is going to be at this place, it's going to be at this place, it's going to be at this place. Obviously, this plays into how we celebrate our festivals. It plays into when we sow our crops, when we harvest. Pongal, Baisakhi, ellame, they're all monsoon-related activities. They all revolve around the monsoon. Our word for the year, our word for anything is always, anything to do with time is always related to the monsoon. So today I am going to talk about mostly about the process of the monsoon, not about the culture of the monsoon, with one very, very special exception. So first, the monsoon itself is a process which consists of 3 different factors. One is the winds, the second is the land and the sea, and the third is the ocean. So we will start with the oceans. We will start with the winds. We need to understand the system of winds that encircle the earth. There are 2 theories. Actually, there were 3 theories, but the third one, the original one was about land breeze and sea breeze, which is completely subsumed by the other theories. It was a very local idea and that is no longer current. So I'm going to skip that. There are 2 theories. One is that the monsoons are caused by the trade winds. And the second is that they are caused by the jet stream. The truth is that both of these factors play a very integral part. And they're actually part of one and the same process, which is the motion of the earth and basically thermodynamics, the heating, differential heating of the earth. We still don't know how much influence each one specifically has. There is still research going on today. I've been reading papers over the last week. There is still research coming out every day, which is completely questioning our understanding of these things, if not overturning them completely. So the way the trade winds happen is, this is a sailing ship, as you can see. The trade winds are a pair of winds that blow roughly from northeast to southwest in the northern hemisphere and southeast to northwest in the southern hemisphere. They are what allowed the sailing ships during the age of sail, that is during the European exploration of the world to actually navigate, because you can be sure that these winds are always blowing in one direction at any given point of the year. So they were so important, and people could not understand what they were, why they were caused and what their differences were. So several people tried to explain them away. Start with, so these blue arrows that you see here are the trade winds. They're slightly different in around the Indian Ocean, but the most easy way to see them is in the Atlantic and Pacific, where there's a lot of place. So the first person to try to explain them was Galileo. So what Galileo thought was this: remember, Galileo was still talking in the time when we were moving just from heliocentrism to geocentrism. So Galileo was talking about the earth spinning eastwards, where he's wrong, and a layer of air above the earth can't keep up with the earth. It has inertia. So as the earth is moving, this layer's chase, and because it's chase, he thought that it presents itself as a wind moving in the opposite direction. So once we actually knew that Galileo was wrong, the next person to try it was Edmund Halley. Yes, of Halley's Comet. So he was the first person to decide that there was something here to do with the heat of the sun. But again, he assumed that there is a stationary earth. The earth is not rotating at all. Only then his particular idea works. He thought that warm air rises, and because it is warm and the night side of the planet is cool, so it will move westwards towards the night side. The only reason that he chose the west was because he had to explain the motion from east to west. It could easily, in his model, it could easily move from west to east also, because from the center where the sun is overhead, it can move on either direction. We have to go further than this. So first, I want to remove the, to understand this, I want to remove the idea of the earth with all the land masses, and we will just talk about the winds alone. A very good example of a world with no land and only wind is Jupiter. And here you can see that the atmosphere has separated into several bands, moving, one is moving this way, one is moving this way, one is moving this way, and so on. This big white central band is the equivalent in Jupiter of our trade winds. The person who came closest in the early modern era was a particular meteorologist called George Hadley. So Hadley was a fellow of the Royal Society. He was not a trained meteorologist. He was not a trained scientist. He was a barrister by profession. He just tended to be more interested in sciences than in his supposed profession. In time, he came to become the person responsible for the Royal Society's meteorological observations. And he was the first one in 1735 to come up with a comprehensive theory. This is a screenshot from the original journal where he published it. And it is worth quoting what he says somewhere in the middle. The perpetual motion of air towards the west cannot merely be derived from the action of the sun upon it. We also have to understand the action of the earth as it rotates. So in his honor, we have something called the Hadley circulation cell in meteorology. So the idea is the sun heats up the planet. There's more heat near the equator, less heat near the poles. Warm air rises up near the equator until it's too heavy to rise. So it moves towards the poles. You can see it happening in this. You can see it happening in this video. Sorry. okay, that's supposed to play for much longer. I will switch to the static image. So warm air, as you can see, rises up near the equator, moves towards the pole. As it moves towards the pole, it cools down over here. And because it's cold at this point, it no longer has buoyancy and it has to drop down. When it drops down, so there is high pressure over here. Because there is air piling upon air, it presses it down. As it presses it down, it has to squeeze and it moves both back towards the equator and again further towards the poles. So this is the first cell. The Hadley cell moves between the equator and about 30 degrees north. There are two other cells in circulation cells like this in on the Earth. They are the feral cell and the polar cell, but we don't need to worry about them too much for the Indian monsoons. We will come to the jet streams later. This only explains the north to south movement of the air in on the Earth's surface. Now, to understand why the trade winds move from east to west, we need to introduce one more factor, which is the Coriolis effect. If I introduce the Coriolis effect in the form that you will find it on the internet, I'll have to fill the page with equations. I will just show you one animation. So what you see here is the white ball is actually standing stationary. It is just moving up and down over the screen. But you can see how, because of the Earth's rotation, it is moving towards the east. For an observer on the Earth, it will appear to move from east to west. And that is why the trade winds are caused. Basically, as the Hadley cell causes pole to equator movement of winds from the winds at the surface, the Coriolis force causes that wind to deflect towards the east, towards the west. Therefore, the trade winds blow from northeast to southwest in the northern hemisphere and southeast to northwest in the southern hemisphere. That is one aspect of the trade wind theory. The second aspect is the point at which the two trade winds meet, which is called the intertropical convergence zone. Like I said, English, Tamil or Sanskrit, we are so influenced by the rains in Akka. England, being a very seafaring nation, was very influenced in its language by the winds. So, English, we have a word called the doldrums. I'm so much in my doldrums. That's because it's the intertropical convergence zone is called the doldrums. And that's a point where ships can't move. If a ship enters the doldrums without having enough speed in it, if we can skip ahead a little bit, it's the ITCZ which causes cyclones which regularly batter the east coast. When we come to that point, I will talk a little bit more on that. So the ITCZ shifts quite far in between the northern and the southern hemisphere over the year. The reason for that is the sun not only rotates, but it also revolves around the earth, around the sun, and more importantly than that, the Earth is also tilted by a small fraction of 23.5 degrees from the straight axis of the Sun, of its orbit. So, I don't think you can see the lower image, but in this one you can see how over time, the sun's rays are moving up and down. The white dot is the sun. So you can see how the sun's rays are illuminating different parts of the earth. So if you can imagine that the place where the sun is directly overhead is where the all the warm air is rising from, then you can see pretty easily how the center of the ITCZ is that point where the air rises from. So that's why the ITCZ keeps shifting between northern and southern hemisphere. But if we read any of our textbooks on the monsoons, we will keep reading this point that the trade winds reverse. The monsoon keeps reversing. But why that happens is that it is not actually the wind which is reversing, but the center of the wind which is moving between the southern and the northern part of the earth. So in the winter, you can see the ITCZ is over here. So the winds are moving in this direction. In the summer, the ITCZ would move up, so you will have the winds moving from the other direction. So the second part of it was the jet streams. If the ITCZ and the trade winds are a very slow, stately pattern which happens at the bottom of the Hadley cell, the top of the cell in the stratosphere, there are these very fast moving patterns called the jet streams. The jet stream is such a new theory that there was no way anybody could have observed it until the mid 20th century. You know, this is something that could only be observed by aircraft moving to the top of the atmosphere, to the stratosphere, and seeing it. In the 1930s, they started noticing these patterns when using weather observation balloons, but nobody really understood what was going on. They just knew that there were some very fast winds. Allied bombers flying over Germany in 1945 would encounter a tailwind when they were moving from Britain to Germany. So they would move into Germany very fast, and after they dropped their bombs, thirumbi poidalam din thirumbi nakka, they would find an enormous headwind and their velocity would drop. They lost multiple flights of bombers purely because they misjudged their airspeed. Ground speed, on one side they would think that they were moving at 119 meters per second. On the other, on the way back, it would drop to just 26 meters per second. And they would they typically met anti-aircraft fire over France and dropped like flies. So the Germans understood this process in about 1939, and it was a German meteorologist who coined the word jet stream. But it wasn't until 1943-44 that the Allies actually understood what was going on. So what happens with the jet stream is this. Cold air from the poles meets with the warm air coming from the equator, just like in the in the trade winds, but this is happening up in the upper atmosphere. The problem is that these two cannot move past each other, so they hit each other, and instead of mixing over there, they're too fast, they too have too much energy, so they slide past each other like that. As they slide, the jet stream is caused, which moves from west to east in one very, very fast stream. So the jet stream is a kind of a balance between the Coriolis force and the pressure gradient. So the Coriolis force is trying to move the winds to one direction. The pressure gradient is the pressure, the low pressure on the outside and the high pressure inside. So that makes the other part of it is buoyancy versus gravity. The air goes up, it's buoyant, but the gravity is pulling it down. As it cools, it goes down, and as it cools, it loses a little bit of its heat. It picks up heat as it comes down, goes back up. So it keeps doing that. These two things are called geostrophic balance and hydrostatic balance. You'll read a lot of these terms when you read about the monsoons. The jet stream, because it keeps getting pushed down and pushed up, it has these things called ridges and troughs. These are troughs and these are ridges. The red parts are ridges and the green parts, blue parts are troughs. There are actually two jet streams. You can see branching over there. There's a jet stream going up north, which is the polar jet stream, and there's a jet stream coming down, which is the subtropical jet stream. They're so incredibly turbulent, and anybody who's flown on an aircraft will know what clear air turbulence feels like. We don't really have a great way of predicting them. They are very difficult. They're very turbulent. They're very fast. And much of the uncertainty of how we predict monsoons actually comes from predicting the jet streams. I'm going to leave the jet streams alone for a moment. I'm going to come back to Earth. I'm going to come back to the land. And then I just want to leave the winds at this point, come back to the land, introduce the land. And then we will go back to how all these three factors get together to create the monsoons as we know them. So the Earth, the amount of land on the Earth is very unbalanced. You can see in the southern hemisphere, there's very little land. This is the equator is somewhere here. So the southern hemisphere has very little land and the northern hemisphere has a lot of land. So the thing about rock is, rock heats up very fast, much faster than water. So there's more heat above the land at all times. Because of this, now then, when I showed the intertropical convergence zone earlier, you might have thought that the ITCZ would be a straight line, but it is not, because there is more heat over here and there is less heat over here. What actually happens is, you can see that there is a lot of heat. So since there's a lot of heat over here, it pulls the ITCZ north in the northern hemisphere summer, that is during the months of May, June, July. It pulls it far north, and it pulls it far south during the winter, when this land is much colder than the water. Whereas if you look at the Atlantic, the shift is very, very small. That's why there are no monsoons in the Atlantic, but there is a heavy monsoon in the Indian Ocean, and there is a lighter monsoon that hits Mexico. So the other part of it is that the land is not homogeneous either. There are mountains in the land. And the mountains are what play a major role in how the southwest trade winds become the southwest monsoon. As far as India is concerned, we need to look at two very specific mountain ranges. One is the Western Ghats and the other is the Himalayas. So the reason that the Western Ghats are important is that they're very close to the coast. When the monsoon wind hits the Western Ghats with all the water and it goes up the mountains, it cools down. When it cools down, its humidity level, the accumulated air over there, becomes cold and wet. It can't stand that pressure, so it condenses and drops as rain. This is why we have lots of rains in Kerala and Karnataka. You can see here how the monsoon wind hits the Western Ghats. And this is what causes the extremely heavy rainfall that you see, for example, in Cochin or Mangalore. The second feature of the Western Ghats is that they will split the monsoon into two different halves. One is the half that goes into the Bay of Bengal, and the other is the half that goes up the Arabian Sea. The Arabian Sea branch becomes orthographic and provides all the rains of the western half of the country. The Bay of Bengal branch does not encounter the country until it slams into Bengal and then it gets turned by the Himalayas. That is why when the Bay of Bengal branch goes all over the bay, picking up moisture as it goes along, slams into the country, hits Bangladesh, floods Bangladesh, moves up, and right at the top of the mountains over there is Cherrapunji, which gets all of that rain. The Arabian Sea monsoon picks up water in the Arabian Sea, but then it disperses it over the entire subcontinent so that you don't see so much of an accumulation of rain in any one part. So now I said that it slams into the Himalayas, it gets turned by the Himalayas once it slams into Bengal. So we need to talk about the Himalayas. The Himalayas provide two very important roles. One is that they provide the same kind of orthographic lift to give water rains to the Gangetic Plain. So when we talk about Gangadhara and Shiva catching the water of the Ganges in his hair, you can think of it, I don't know if this is what was intended by the poet, but you can think of it as the rain clouds going up the Himalayas being caught and being redirected as flow down the Ganges. The other thing that they do is that they confine this heavy wet laden air inside India and don't allow it to go up into Tibet, which is why Tibet is a very dry plateau. The Himalayas also act as a barrier which breaks the jet stream into two. So the blue region you see in the middle between the two, the upper branch of the jet stream and the lower branch of the jet stream, is the Tibetan plateau. So this is what happens in the winter. This is actually what happens just before the monsoon. What happens is that the jet stream is broken up into two branches, and the southern branch is over the Indian subcontinent. Because it's over the Indian subcontinent and this is a ridge, that means that there is a higher mass of air in the jet stream at this over the subcontinent at this point. Because of this, there is high pressure over here. High pressure does not allow the rain-bearing clouds to form, and it prevents any rain from occurring during the winter months. In the summer, what happens is the Tibetan plateau heats up and the jet stream gets pulled up over the Himalayas. Because of that, now there is enough area for a low pressure to form inside the subcontinent, and that allows the rain bearing clouds to stop and give us rain. The second and also because the Himalayas are there, those rain bearing clouds do not get and are not allowed to move beyond that, and this system is maintained in equilibrium until the sun begins its journey further down. And because of these mountain ranges, because of the landmass and the difference in weight between the north and the south, this picture is no longer correct, and this is the surface picture that we have, a very chaotic and turbulent system in the Indian Ocean which breaks into two branches. You can see the two branches very clearly over here. This region, the blue region you see in the bottom, is the ITCZ. All of that is the turbulence of the monsoons happening. Okay, now after this much dry science, let's go to something more interesting. Let's see how we experience the monsoons, and as we do, we will also talk about how the monsoon progresses. The most interesting, most talked about aspect of the monsoon is how it bursts. ஒரு நாள் சடனாக இஃப் யூஆர் சிட்டிங் ஆன் த கோஸ்ட் ஆஃப் கேரளா யூ கேன் ஆக்சுவலி சீ கிளவுட்ஸ் ரஷிங் இன். இது வந்து திஸ் இஸ் காளிதாசாஸ் மேகதூதா. ஸோ இந்த வேர்ஸில் வந்து ஹீ சேஸ் அ கிளவுட் த சார்ஜ் த பீக் இன் மிமிக் ஃப்ரே ஆஸ் அன் எலிஃபென்ட் அட்டாக்ஸ் அ பேங்க் ஆஃப் அர்த் இன் பிளே. அப்படியே ஒரு மதம் பிடிச்ச யானை மாதிரி வந்து மோதர் தான் அந்த இதில். ஸோ திஸ் ஐ எக்ஸ்பீரியன்ஸ்ட் மை செல்ஃப் லாஸ்ட் இயர் பிகாஸ் இன் ஜூன் வி வர் இன் கேரளா. And on the Cochin coast, you can actually see a dry day. This is the monsoon clouds approaching Cochin. The day is initially dry, then the clouds come, and then within a few minutes you have rain. And what you can see is the clouds just move over your overhead, bursting as they go. You can actually experience that elephant charging if you're on the west coast. So to sum up, the ITCZ moves slowly north to south, and it's mostly in place. Actually, in this point of time, the intertropical convergence zone is already in place over the subcontinent. By mid-May, everything is ready. Ana. டிபெட்டில் ஹீட் வந்து ஜெட் ஸ்ட்ரீம் மைக்ரேட்ஸ் நார்த். ஆன் தட் டே த வின்ஸ் ஆர் சக்ட் இன் டு த இந்தியன் சப் கான்டினென்ட் அண்ட் தென் யூ ஹாவ் த பர்ஸ்டிங் ஆஃப் த மான்சூன்ஸ். ஸோ லெட்ஸ் லுக் அட் த பாத் ஆஃப் த மான்சூன்ஸ். அண்ட் காளிதாசரையே நான் வந்து ஒரு டூர் கைடாக யூஸ் பண்ணிக்கிறேன். For Kalidasa, the monsoons, he starts the monsoons in Ramagiri, which is probably somewhere on the Western Ghats. The setup of Meghaduta is that there is a Yaksha who is separated from his wife, who is living in Kailasa, Mount Kailasa, and he has been exiled to a place in somewhere in modern-day Maharashtra. So he asks a passing monsoon cloud to take a love letter from him to his wife. And the whole of Meghaduta is how he describes the what all the cloud will see as he goes from Maharashtra to Kailasa. The first stop is the valley of the river Reva, which is the river Narmada. The Reva River, which gaily breaks on Vindhya's rocky side like painted streaks upon elephant's gingy hide. So anybody who's seen the Narmada at its mouth will be able to see how it streaks blue streaks on a brown, grayish brown land. அதான் டிஸ்கிரைப் பண்ணுறார். ஸோ த மான்சூன் ஹஸ் கான் அப் த கோஸ்ட் ஆஃப் இந்தியா அண்ட் இட் இஸ் என்டரிங் இந்தியா த்ரூ நர்மதா. நெக்ஸ்ட் இட் ரீச்சஸ் உதயகிரி. த லோன் லயிங் ஹில் அட் செட்டில் அண்ட் ரெஸ்ட் இட்ஸ் கதம்பா ட்ரீஸ் வில் சீம் டு த்ரில் அட் தை எம்ப்ரேஸ். ஸோ இங்கே வந்து இட் ஹஸ் என்டர்ட் இன் டு த சப் கான்டினென்ட் அட் Narmada and it's progressing little further east into Udayagiri. Third stop is Ujjain. Ujjain was such an important place for Kalidasa that he spends multiple stanzas just describing the city. Inga vandha the cloud konja naal appadiye konja rest edutundu adutha edathukku pogum. Then after Ujjain we move up the Narmada valley and move on towards the holy peak. I don't know what the holy peak is, but probably some mountain in the Vindhyas. Anga poittu the next it moves further north and hits Kurukshetra. I wasn't able to find a decent monsoon image of Kurukshetra, so I didn't put it in. after Kurukshetra, visit the daughter of Janu. The daughter of Janu is the Ganga as she descends from the Himalayas to form a stairway to heaven for Sagara's sons. This particular point, Kanakala actually describes a village near Haridwar. So the monsoon has now reached Haridwar. It is standing on top of it's standing at the crest of the Indian subcontinent. Ingendu move up to Mount Krauncha, the gateway of the Hamsas, the Bhrigu Lord's path of glory. Pursue thy way northwards, beautiful in thy sloping elongation, as the dark foot of Vishnu striding forth to punish Bali. So the wind inga vandu takes a step up onto the Himalayas in an imagery that is like Trivikrama putting his foot up. This Krauncha passes in Kumaun. Idukapuram, the monsoon wind has actually crossed over from India. The last verse is on Mount Kailasa, and since it has left India at this point, I'm going to also leave the Meghaduta. These place identifications I got from this particular paper, which was published in 2012. It's actually a very fascinating paper with a lot of details on why they think that each one of these places, what they think. Arabian Sea branch, I have Kalidasa. Bay of Bengal, unfortunately, I have nothing except images. So I will just show you the path of the monsoon as it goes up from the Bay of Bengal. First, it hits Bengal, where it typically causes heavy flooding in Bangladesh. From there, it goes up into Meghalaya. And as we know, Cherrapunji and Mausam Ram are the rainiest places on earth. The geography of Meghalaya is such that you see these two valleys. This is at Cherrapunji. This is a picture that we took. There is a third mountain over here which is blocking it. So the wind gets funneled into, if the mountains are like this, the wind gets funneled into them, piling up at this third mountain which is holding it back. Cherrapunji is sitting on this corner of the mountains, and that's why it gets so much rain. After reaching Meghalaya, it turns northwest, enters the Brahmaputra Valley. If you visit the Brahmaputra, if you visit Assam, you will see that nobody, inga vandu namba kuvama irukatom, idu kaveri irukatom, it might be the Ganga, we keep encroaching onto the banks of these rivers, we do something. Nobody in Assam will mess with the Brahmaputra. Enu ketaka, they will tell you have not seen the Rudra Roop, you are coming in this easy season. When Brahmaputra is in spate, nobody can stand it. Part of that is the monsoon, and part of that is the melting of the water from the Tibetan plateau. From Brahmaputra, it reaches Bihar, and at Bihar, it starts going up again over the Gangetic Valley and meets up with the other branch coming from the Arabian Sea, and becomes a single monsoon again up somewhere near Delhi. So this is the path. The western path that you see is the path described by Meghaduta. The reason for the kink there is that Kalidasa wants us to visit Ujjain. This eastern path, the reason for the kink over here is that the Kashigaru hills just make the monsoon winds take a right turn. Take a left turn. Then goes right up the Gangetic Plain. So this process is the advancement of the monsoon. Finally, by around August, the entire subcontinent is filled with clouds because of this process. And then in September, the sun has started its journey back south. Dakshinayana aarambichittu, it will start coming towards the center of the subcontinent. From Tropic of Cancer, it starts coming down to the middle of the subcontinent. In late September is when we start seeing our monsoon, because the ITCZ is now at about 10 degrees of latitude. And the Tibetan Plateau also starts cooling down at this point. So the jet stream migrates again further south, causing high pressure again in the north of the country. And the prevailing wind is now we see the wind changing direction. Now the wind which was blowing from the southwest is now changed, and now the wind is blowing from the northeast. There is high pressure all over the north, and the monsoon clouds have expended their rains, and there is no more clouds coming in from rolling in from the south to replenish them. So it feels like the monsoons are retreating. It's not actually that the monsoons are retreating, there is just no more reinforcement of the monsoon cloud coming from the south. They have expanded, and then the wind has started blowing whatever remains back out into the sea. In the season, Lada, you see the last few arrows coming down the Bay of Bengal. They will pick up the waters, the moisture from the bay, because the south of the world is still very warm. They will pick up the waters from the bay and start dumping it over coastal Andhra and Tamil Nadu. That's why we get our rains in September, October, November, first week of December. இது வந்து அகனானூர்லேருந்து ஒரு பேசேஜ். இங்கே அந்த மாமழை அப்படிங்கிற வார்த்தை ரெண்டாவது லைனில் வரும். இந்த சீசனை தான் ஆர் போயட்ஸ் ஹவ் டிஸ்கிரைப்ட் இன் தமிழ். பிளாக் ப்ரெக்னென்ட் க்ரௌட்ஸ் பிரிங் த மான்சூன் இன் ஸ்டே. Between the flower and the blue gem flower of the on the blue bilberry tree, red black moths, pattu poochi multiply with the fallen jasmines, idella nammalku namba monsoon odia scenes idella. In the season, because the intertropical convergence zone is right over the middle of the peninsula, you will see ITCZ, because it's a place where two winds are meeting, there will be small circulations or kutti kutti eddies form a home. Two or three of these eddies meet, they can become bigger, 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 and then they accumulate into a cyclone. That is why the southern coast, especially in that season, in the northeast monsoon season, especially during the time when the ITCZ is right over us, அப்போ தான் நம்மளுக்கு மேக்ஸிமம் சைக்ளோன்ஸ் வர ஆரம்பிக்கும். ஸோ ஃப்ரம் அபவுட் மிட் அக்டோபர் டு டிசம்பர் வி வில் ஸ்டார்ட் சீயிங் சைக்ளோன்ஸ். ஃபர்தர் இன் த சீசன், வென் த கன்வர்ஜன் ஜோன் ஹேஸ் கம் டவுன் ஃபர்தர் சவுத், வாட் ஹேப்பன்ஸ் இஸ் த சைக்ளோன் ஸ்டார்ட் ஃபார்மிங் சம்வேர் நியர் த சுமாத்ரன் கோஸ்ட். அங்கேருந்து தே வில் again the prevailing direction is still towards the east, yeah, so they will be get blown towards the east and they will hit our coast. Andha madri or cyclone da vadra, which is why it was a late breaking cyclone. This is the basic process of how the monsoon advances and retreats. So this much idha paathaka you would think that it's a very regular process. But then every year, நம்மளுக்கு வந்து ஆர் என்டையர் கண்ட்ரி ஸ்டார்ட்ஸ் திங்கிங் இப்போ மான்சூன் இப்போ வருமா வராதா, நல்ல மான்சூனா இல்லையா, இஸ் இட் கோயின் டு பி ஏர்லி, இஸ் இட் கோயின் டு பி லேட், Is this northeast monsoon going to happen at all? Is it not going to happen? So the second part of the talk, I would like to concentrate upon the vagaries of the monsoon. So we need to see what else can disturb the, this particular process from happening. One major topic that I have not talked about, I have talked about the winds, I have talked about the land and the sea, but I have not talked about the sea surface temperatures. We will find that they play a major role in disturbing the monsoon rather than actually causing it. அது வந்து மெடிட்ரேனியன் கோஸ்ட்லேயும் பிளாக் சீலையும் நடக்கிற ஒன்று. அங்கேருந்து ஒரு சைக்ளோனிக் ஸ்டார்ம் ஆரம்பித்து இட் ஸ்டார்ட்ஸ் மூவிங் டுவர்ட்ஸ் தி ஈஸ்ட். திஸ் ஹேப்பன்ஸ் டிபிக்லி டியூரிங் த ப்ரீ மான்சூன் டைம், டியூரிங் த வின்டர். தீஸ் வெஸ்டர்ன் டிஸ்டர்பன்சஸ் கேன் ப்ரொடியூஸ் by the time they reach India, they can interact with the monsoons and produce very intense rainfall because there are two systems colliding in the same axis. So in 2013, there were floods in North India which killed 5,000 people in a span of 3 days. Probably, we don't know, probably this was a result of such an interaction. So this is one of the smaller disturbances that can actually happen in the monsoon. Now, periya or disturbance pesanonakka, let's talk about the dipoles. Dipoles are circulation cells which happen east to west instead of from north to south. The Hadley cell na sonnadhu vandu, they happen from north to south like this. These dipoles happen from east to west. So there was a director general of observatories in India in 1904 called Gilbert Walker. A very severe failure of the monsoon which caused a major famine. He wanted to understand why this happened. So he undertook a monumental 15-year task to study this and understand it. And at the end of it, his contributions were so influential that the British government awarded him a knighthood. This particular phenomenon that he found was what we today call the El Nino. The basic thing that creates the El Nino is called the Walker circulation cell. It's named after him. So under normal circumstances, you will see that on the South American coast, there is cold water in the ocean, and there is warm water near the coast of Australia and Papua New Guinea. Trade winds are also blowing east to west. The warm ocean current moves, so the water moving from South America to Australia becomes warmer as it goes along, and the air rises, cooling down, and then cools down the Peruvian coast again. This is what normally should happen. Even these processes of they're not happening in isolation. This is happening along with the Hadley cell over the Pacific. So when the trade winds are weak, what happens is that the warm ocean current pushes towards the Peruvian coast, causing heat near the Peruvian coast. This pushes the cold water down into the sea, and that starts moving back towards the Australian coast and upswells at the near Australia and Papua New Guinea. Because of this, the Walker cell is now actually broken into two. There is one the warm air, because of this upswell, there is a cold patch over here and a warm patch over here. The warm air rises over here itself and rains over North America and rains over Peru. Whereas the cold air, which is still dry near Australia, rises up and it falls down again over about Vietnam. This causes Western Australia to become dry. It causes rains in South America. And for India, what actually happens, even though it's not mentioned in this map, it starts weakening the Indian summer monsoon due to basically, because this is dry, it starts sucking the moisture away from the Indian monsoon into Indonesia. Other parts of the globe will start seeing alternating wet and dry areas. So, on the other hand, I found this paper, and the El Nino actually influences the Indian, the northeast monsoon in totally the opposite way. What happens is, Gandhi, you can see 1956, there was a high northeast monsoon, and there was a high, the numbers above 1 will indicate a high El Nino. 1949, there was a La Nina. We will come to the La Nina later. 1965, there was a high El Nino. You see, in 1966, there was a high northeast monsoon. Again, you can see 1987, 132 mm above normal. And the El Nino index, the temperature anomaly was 1 degree above. So, 1 degree change is all that it takes to create an El Nino or a La Nina. And that 1 degree change in ocean temperature, sea surface temperature, causes an amazing increase in the an amazing decrease in the southwest monsoon and an amazing increase in the northeast monsoon. 2015, just for reference, was an El Nino year. Not a strong one, a weak one, but still enough that we got what we got. On the other hand, the La Nina is causes a strengthening of the trade winds, because this, what happens is the cold water surfaces much earlier near the South American coast, so it pushes the trade winds much faster towards Asia. And what happens is the Walker cell is strengthened, and like the El Nino causes drought because the Walker cell is weakened, the La Nina causes intense monsoons in India because the Walker cell is much stronger. Now, 2016, when we got very low rain, was a relatively weak La Nina year. Again, the temperature anomaly was only about 1 degree, and that was enough to push us over the limit. And North India was having several floods. South India did not get any rains. Southeast India did not get any rains. This is again an overview of how La Nina affects the world. Most of India becomes cooler, making the north of India cool and wet. It also causes very extreme rains in Indonesia and warm and wet climate over Papua New Guinea. Thing about the ENSO is that it doesn't happen the same every year. It is not as predictable a year-on-year phenomenon as the monsoon itself. In the end, the El Nino, this Walker cell is affected by such small temperature gradients. It is actually affected by the wobble of the earth as it moves around the sun. When the earth is, there is a 11-year cycle or 10-year cycle between when the earth is slightly closer to the sun and slightly farther away. When we are slightly closer to the sun, there is more heat and we start getting an El Nino. When we are slightly farther away, we get a La Nina because it's much cooler. In the varshathukku vandu, according to NOAA in the US, the odds are for a slightly increasing El Nino in the later year, but there are equal chances for nothing actually happening and the Walker cell remaining as it is. So because of this, I believe that in the varshathukku vandu, the El Nino is not going to be such a strong factor as it was in previous years. Similar to the El Nino, there is another Walker cell between the coast of Somalia in Africa and Java in Indonesia, Java, Sumatra in Indonesia. This is called the Indian Ocean Dipole. This one varies again, it varies between every 3 to 5 years. A positive Indian Ocean Dipole normally has a very positive effect on both Indian summer and the Northeast monsoon. 2015 was a positive IOD year, so we got decent rains in North India and extremely good rains in South India. So when these two, there was another paper I would like to quote here. When these two ocean processes, the El Nino and the La Nina, happen together, the low level Pacific Divergence Center occurs during an El Nino is weakened, and this forms an anomalous Walker cell over the Indian Ocean Dipole, separate from the Walker cell over the Pacific. So what they conclude is, when both of these things happen, it results in an anomalously surplus Indian summer monsoon, such as in the year 1997. When the positive IOD event occurs, both the poles of the IOD contribute to surplus rainfall over India and thereby reduce the El Nino influence. These people have performed certain numerical experiments on computers which demonstrate that the net combined influence of this ocean process depends on a lot of phase small variables which just completely change the way that the whole system behaves. The fact that the IOD has apparently weakened the ENSO monsoon relationship makes the Indian Ocean Dipole a very useful indicator for the Indian summer monsoon rainfall. This is how they conclude. So with all of these facts before us, I have to go into a topic which I know Gopuru is not going to agree with me on. We don't necessarily agree on the cause of global warming, but I think we can agree that temperatures are rising. The problem is temperatures are, this hockey stick graph only tells you global mean temperature. The fact is that some parts of the earth are getting much warmer, some parts are getting much cooler. And because of that, there is a very, very drastic effect on the Indian summer monsoon, which I will explain in the next few slides. So the amount of energy in the power generated by the all of these winds circulating around the equator is about 400 petawatts. I don't know if the whole Earth's electricity generation capacity has gone to 1 petawatt. So global warming is about an increase in the amount of energy in this system. The problem is that it is not just one few watts of energy increasing over 1 year. It's a year on year accumulation of energy within the system, and it just builds up in some parts of the earth and dissipates in some other parts. We can't talk very easily about how global warming has caused a flood in 1 year or drought in another year. We can only talk about averages. This particular paper, Andrew Turner and Annamalai have examined, this is actually a review paper of several other papers, and they have examined what will happen to the Indian summer monsoon over the next 50 years. They have taken data from the 1950s onwards, and they have tried to analyze and tell us what will happen over the next 50 years also. So what they say is, the first image that you see here is the mean across 20 different papers that they have found, and all of them you can see show increase of precipitation in India. The right side is a subset of these four models which they thought was the best. So you can see again, Gujarat Rajasthan mele, you're going to see even less rains, which is exactly what Gujarat and Rajasthan really need at this point. And more rains over South India, more rains over UP, basically. Their conclusions were, the CMIP3 model, this is one particular research that was done, generally show that drier conditions over South Asia in the future are going to be rare, meaning we are going to see a lot more intensity in our monsoons. They go on to say that analyzing the daily gridded rainfall observations reveals a decrease in moderate rainfall events of 5 to 100 mm per day, but an increase in extreme events over central India since the 1950s. And they go on to say that we are going to see even more of an increase over the next several years. And as time goes on, we are going to see a contraction of the monsoon period to fewer and fewer days, while it is going to become more and more intense. Leading back to where I started all of this journey in the year 2015, when I started studying the rains. If you remember, December 1st, it started raining. December 5th, there were no rains. 3 or 4 days, we had something like 1000 mm of rain. In the previous part of the season, again in November, actually in early November, I wasn't in the country. I came back just in time for the rains to stop. So I left, first week of November, and I was back in the third week of November. In that 1 week, every single area in the Chennai area was full. Chembrambakkam was standing at 86 feet. So what we are going to see is that intense compressed rainfall over a short period of time, and an expansion of the dry season. We need to be prepared for scenes like this. This is in Bombay. This was a flood in Bihar. This is the Uttarakhand floods a few years back. So basically, we need to be prepared. We need to be prepared to deal with this heavy short bursts of rain, and we need to be prepared to deal with these with a large long dry spell, meaning that we need a lot more water storage. So we are going to see a lot more of this situation where we have floods 1 year, a cyclone, a drought, again flood, again drought. Much more intense, much more compressed. This was my conclusion from my last few months of looking at the summer monsoon. I haven't covered everything. I cannot cover everything, but I hope that I have done justice as much as I could to the topic. Thank you.
We'll have some questions, and then we'll, if there are not enough questions, then.
Why is it that earlier the usual phenomenon used to be in October and all, there used to be
That's such a turbulent system, sir. I tried looking for data on why these things are happening, and the very short answer that everybody gives is, we don't even know if this is permanent, and we don't know why this is actually happening. Everybody you look at, every paper that you look at, every expert that you talk to will give you a different answer on why it's happening. But one thing that we can be sure of is, it is in that season that cyclones will develop, depending on probably specific local heat conditions in the north or the south of the Bay of Bengal, they will be turned up or down. And it's not like we haven't had cyclones in Nagapattinam in the recent times either. We have. It's just that they have been less intense or less in number.
I'll repeat my question. If the Himalayas deflect the southwest monsoon, you would expect it to go northwest. Why is it that it turns around and comes back as northeast?
It doesn't turn around and come back. Let me just go back to that slide. What happens is actually that by the time the monsoon, by the time that you see the northeast monsoon happening, what has happened is that the convergence zone has moved from the red area. The red is the convergence zone in mid-June. This is the convergence zone in mid-December. So the convergence zone when the northeast monsoon starts is somewhere just at the southern coast, southern tip of India. So above the convergence zone, the winds are moving from the northeast. Below the convergence zone, the winds are moving from the southwest. When the convergence zone itself drops and when the jet stream creates a high pressure over there, it looks to us, when we are sitting in one place and looking, it looks to us like the winds are reversing. But the winds are not actually reversing. The entire system is shifting down.
So it's a very general question, sir. You said it during northeast monsoon and the eddies were formed in Sumatra and all these things.
Yeah.
But the general direction of movement, if you see, they say வடக்கு நோக்கி நகர்ந்து கொண்டிருக்கிறது, வடமேற்கு நோக்கி நடந்து கொண்டிருக்கிறது, something like that only. From Sri Lanka, the cyclone zones, they will come towards Nagapattinam, then Kadalur, then Chennai, then go to Andhra Pradesh, like that. But we call it as a northeast monsoon.
Yeah.
But the monsoon movement is towards south east to northwest.
Yes. And the answer to that is to look at something like this. This blue, yeah, if you see the blue region over there, that is the intertropical convergence zone. Cyclones will form along that blue line. One second, I'll just show you.
Cyclones typically form over here along this blue line. During the northeast monsoon time, the zone is right over Tamil Nadu. So what happens is
the cyclones actually start forming at that point, and they're always moving towards the west.
Northeast
to southwest. East to west is the general direction. Northeast to southwest is the prevailing direction. But the cyclones have a tendency to move towards the north also because they're spiraling towards the north.
No, every year, whenever you see open the TV report or whatever it is, it's a
type that thing. Yeah, so that's exactly why I wanted to do this, because I did not concentrate so much on cyclogenesis in this talk. Because that itself is one big ocean. But what actually, in very brief, what actually happens is that the cyclones form near Sumatra when the ITCZ is just slightly above, in the middle of the peninsula. So the prevailing direction for the cyclonic wind is still towards the north. But the prevailing direction for the rain-bearing winds is from the north, from northeast to southwest.
With reference to what sir said, and he was talking about the winds getting diverted. My understanding is that always winds, they have the movement from high pressure area to low pressure area. That is the fundamental.
Yes.
Because that is how the southeast trade winds, when they cross equator, the low pressure in the Indian subcontinent, they attract the southeast trade winds, they get attracted towards the low pressure in the northern hemisphere.
Yes.
After crossing equator, they take a right turn because of Coriolis force based on the Ferrell's law. Coming to the point what sir said, they say it is always moving north, west, northwest, because cyclones, they have the tendency always to move towards west and northwest. And the place where they are likely to cross the coast, it depends on the pressure condition. That is how in the last 10 years, the India Meteorological Department, they are able to predict the cyclone, which coast it crosses. So the accuracy has come to great extent based on the pressure condition they cross. Because always, again, the basic fundamental is moving from high pressure to low pressure area. That is how, even with the reference to Himalayas, wherever there is a low pressure, winds have the tendency to move.
Yes, sir.
That is how it is.
Yes, sir. And as I said, the jet stream actually creates the high pressure or removes the high pressure from the North India. And that's what actually attracts the winds into India. And yes, I did not so much concentrate on the Northeast monsoon this time, but the other thing is, one question I have here is, what causes the high pressure over the pressure difference on the Indians, on the eastern coast of India, which attracts, what causes the low pressure on the eastern coast of India, which attracts the cyclones during the Northeast monsoon? I have not fully answered that question. Probably over this monsoon, I should concentrate on that a little bit.
Again, with reference to Northeast monsoon, now the rays of the sun starts falling vertically over southern hemisphere.
Yes.
So where low pressure is in the southern part, high pressure in the northern part. So that is how the Northeast trade winds start moving from Northeast to Southeast.
Yes.
That is where we get the rainfall, picking up the moisture from the Bay of
Bengal. Yeah. Yes. If you can get on a flight right now and go to Kochi or Mangalore, you'll have a real treat. This process is going to go on for the entire monsoon in Mangalore, Cochin, and all those areas. So it's not a bad time to visit, and any time between June, July, to see these things. You can also, if you are brave enough to brave the 10,000 mm of rainfall, you can go to Cherrapunji in about, 10-20 days time. You might, June 20th or so, 20 days time. If you're in Cherrapunji, you'll see a treat. The rest of the year, if you go to Cherrapunji, you'll find it absolutely dry. And it actually has a water shortage. It's just amazing how that works. Yeah, it just flows off. There's nothing to hold it. It's water shortage. I was in Cherrapunji in December, and we're looking around to see where the rains are. So, yeah.
Thank you, Shashwath. That was a wonderful lecture. It's a lot of very graphical media representation of several aspects of the monsoon that I think we generally don't get to see, either in, in our school education or in public fora. It's wonderful. I hope, the TV crews invite him to explain some of this, and so, give somewhere between, all the yelling and the shouting, some little coverage of what actually is happening would be very interesting. Things like the jet stream and how, you know, very recent advances and in technology have helped us understand at least some of these phenomena. So I hope that happens soon. So thank you once again very, very much for this wonderful lecture. Normally we don't do this, but we have Mr. Nalaswamy from the Indian Meteorological Department, and he's just recently retired head of their research division, and he wants to add a few comments. So hopefully we'll have time for that, about 5 minutes. Thank you, sir.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. When I was invited for this talk, Indian monsoon, which is very close to my heart, I served about 36 years in meteorological department, and still I am, even though I am retired from government service, but the science has no retirement, so I continue it. My job is actually now presently to go to the educational institutions, organize the seminars, educate the people, request the government of Tamil Nadu to include in the syllabus so that fundamentals can be studied. This monsoon is a very, very big topic. Our today's speaker, when I came, I was expecting a gentleman like me. But I saw a young scientist in front of me, and he has picked up a lot of information, which is pretty high actually in standard. You can even slow down some of the things. People will reach to the more people. So about monsoon, you can go on, talk hours together, days together. Let us not do. Most of the points he has mentioned, I appreciate, but still, there are some of the things I don't want to interfere in this question and answer session also. I could thank one of the gentlemen who was appreciating this the cyclone tracking system, that's true, it has happened. But monsoon vagaries, it's a very, very complicated because of the tropical region has got its nature by itself. You can predict in America, you can predict it in Australia, pinpointing. It will happen means it will happen. But in India, it is not possible. In Chennai or Andaravaram, you take 50 kilometers, you will have some areas, the heavy rainfall, some areas no rainfall. So the forecast is considered as positive for those who have got the rain. And those who have not got the rain say that the forecast is failed. So that's apart from that. Anyway, as he told about the global warming, I think you are having any topic on that, global warming?
Not yet.
Okay. There are so many studies going on. See, those days, from historically, he has mentioned so many things. But latest things are out. This ENSO, easterly jet, La Nina, dipole, all those things, and now computer prognosis and analysis, all these things are done. But still, the manly handling it, the India Meteorological Department, which started in 1875, the origin of the observatory is in Lungambakkam, which is in 1792, that was meant for astronomical purpose, but later on the meteorology has. So I will first of all congratulate this young budding scientist for this. And my reason is nature cannot be beaten, or actually you cannot escape from natural calamities. You cannot stop it. Only thing is you have to learn, understand, take precautionary measures, then we'll live accordingly. It may be, as you said, rainfall may be high intensity, cyclones may be high intensity, but studies are going on worldwide. Dr. Annamalai, whom he has referred, I had the opportunity to invite him to talk on the subject. He's a climatological expert person from Hawaii University. Still it is, so don't get, please don't get panic. Don't compare with other events. If it, last year it was like that. For a simple word, I'm finishing it with one more this one. To this month, what was the prediction given by IMD is different. I'm not representing IMD now. I'm just a general person. இந்த வருஷம் அக்னி நட்சத்திரத்தில் வெயில் காயும் தலை காயும் இந்த மாதிரி ஒரு ஸ்டேட்மெண்ட். பட் இட் இஸ் நாட் ஸோ. சென்னை இஸ் ப்ராபர்லி த கூலஸ்ட் சம்மர் திஸ் இயர். இட் இஸ் நாட் கிராஸ்ட் 40 டிகிரி செல்சியஸ் மச் ஆஃப் த டைம். சம்டைம்ஸ் யூ யூஸ் டு பி தேர் ஃபார் 10 டேஸ் அண்ட் ஆல் திஸ். ஸோ இட்ஸ் ஆல் இட் இஸ் இவால்விங் ப்ராசஸ். இஸ் இட் சப்ஜெக்ட் which has got enormous scope of studying. Now everywhere they have taken up, IITs they have taken up. Now clubbing with these departments like NIOT, IITM, all those things are all taking care of this one. So we will go according to nature, but we will definitely, we will find solution for any problem which we are facing. So with this, I thank you for giving me this opportunity. I once again thanks. Actually, I was introduced to my friend Mr. Sivashankar Babu, and I thank him for giving this one because I am not touching that this one. His topic is entirely different from what I could have talked. This is different. Anyway, I once again congratulate him. If any help you he needs also, I am prepared to spare it. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much, everybody, for coming to this program. Our next program, as I said, is next month. Next lecture, it will be by Dr. Sita Sundar Ram of the Kupusami Sastri Research Institute. She'll be talking about a Tamil mathematical work called the Astana Kolahalam. That will be on the fourth Saturday. If you want us to intimate you, please go to our Facebook page, Varahamihira Science Forum. Just search for RMS Science Forum in Facebook. You'll find it. Or give one of us your phone number and we'll add you to the WhatsApp groups. Thank you very much.